Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
About TCS. What is TCS? First of all, what is the full form of TCS? So kindly note, TCS stands for tax collection at source. That is collection of tax at source. So that is basically TCS. And like TDS and like advanced tax, it is, you may say, it is also a way of collection of tax. And basically, TCS is basically used in order to collect the tax at the earliest. And one unique feature of TCS is there that differentiates it from TDS. And we will be discussing all these features in this particular video. So be with me and let us start. Now, TCS is particularly a device in order to collect the tax. And it is there for quicker collection of tax, and mainly as we have discussed earlier also, that these provisions regarding TDS, regarding TCS, these are basically there. First part is in order to collect the tax at the earliest, and secondly, in order to avoid, in order to check, in order to control the possibilities of chances of tax evasion. So, in order to avoid any leakage, from the, you may say, revenue of the central government, such provisions have been implemented. And these are, believe me, these are very much effective also. So, regarding TCS, let us move further. Kindly note that under section 206C, subsection 1, sellers of certain goods are required to collect tax from the buyers at the specified rate. First of all, you should note that section 206C, subsection 1 deals with that, and various provisions are there. It is not applicable on everybody. Various particular cases are there, special cases are there. And we will be studying in that. And in case, I will be telling you, in case the purchaser, the licensee or the lessee is a non-resident, non-corporate assessee, or even a non-domestic company, in that case, in addition to the applicable tax, the health and education cess will also be required to be collected. Now let us see, first of all, what are the provisions of applicability of TCS. As I have already told you that it is not applicable on everybody. So what are the cases, what are the circumstances where TCS is applicable? So let us start. First of all, in TDS, I am referring back to TDS. And I am dealing with the TDS in order to make you understand TCS in an effective way. First of all, kindly note what was there in TDS. In TDS, it was the duty of the deductor. It was the duty of the payer to deduct the tax while making any payment to the, you may say, seller. So, but it is not so in TCS. What is there in tax collection at source? It is just the reverse of, it is just the opposite of TDS. So what will be there? Let us start. Now, every seller shall collect. It is a duty of the, it is a responsibility of the seller to collect tax from the buyer of any specified goods. I will be telling you what is the definition of specified goods. I will be also discussing with you who is buyer, who is seller, as per the provisions of TCS. But first of all, let's move. Let's understand that every seller, it is the duty of every seller to collect a tax from the buyer of any specified goods. When, what is the time? So it is the debiting the amount payable by the buyer to his account, or a receipt of amount from the buyer, whichever is earlier. So it is the first point. Now secondly, in the first point it was seller, and in the second point it is the duty of every person who grants a lease, a license, or transfer, or enters into a contract and transfers any right in basically some parking may be there, parking contract may be there, or some toll plaza may be there, or it may be relating to some mine or some quarry to other person. So it should be noted. And at again at the same time, the rules applicable are that the amount should be collected. You may say TCS, the tax should be collected from the licensee or lessee at the time of debiting the amount payable by the licensee or lessee, or a receipt of such amount from the licensee or lessee, again whichever is earlier. So it is a basically point of taxation. Now third, one main provision is there. Kindly note, it is very main provision, and you should know it very carefully, and it is very often used. What is this provision? Every person being, we are talking of seller, who receives an amount as consideration for sale of motor vehicle. Kindly note, it may be any motor vehicle, not only, it is not so that it is applicable on luxury cars only. So, every person who receives a consideration more than rupees 10 lakh, this is the ceiling limit, this is the main limit, 10 lakh, it is his or her duty to collect tax from the buyer at the rate of 1% of sale consideration. So, it should be noted that where the amount of motor vehicle is more than 10 lakhs, then in that case, it is the duty of the person selling, that is seller, to collect tax from the buyer at the rate of 1%. But kindly note that this provision will not be applicable on sale of motor vehicles by manufacturers to their dealers or distributors. It is not applicable in that part. And secondly, one thing that is required to be noticed in this provision, that is, it is applicable on each and every sale, and it is not applicable, it is not so that it is applicable to the aggregate value of the sale, rather it is applicable to each and every sale made during the year. Now, in the particular case, just now we had used the words buyer, seller, specified goods. So first of all, in order to know TCS and its applicability in a better way, we must know who is buyer, who is considered to be seller, and what are the specified goods. So first of all, I am starting with buyer. Kindly note, as far as section 206, as far as section 206C, subsection 1 and 1C are concerned, then who is buyer? Buyer is a person who obtains in any sale by way of auction, tender, or through any other mode, goods of the nature specified in the table in subsection 1 of the, you may say, table that is specified in subsection 1, or who acquire the right to receive any goods but does not include. Kindly note, who is not included in that? It is basically a public sector company, central government, a state government and an embassy, a high commission, you may say. So, secondly, a buyer in the retail sale of goods who has purchased the goods only for personal consumption. So these, you should note that these will not be included. And for others, for section 206, subsection 1F, kindly note, a person who obtains in any sale goods of specified nature but doesn't include, again, central government, state government, embassy, high commission, and all that, and trade representation, consulate, foreign state, that is not included, and a local authority, and again a public sector company which is engaged in the business of carrying passenger. On these provisions are not applicable, so these will not be included under the definition of buyer. Now, who is seller? Again, seller may be the central government, state government, any local authority, corporation, authority, any authority established by or under an act of, you may say, central government, state government, any company, firm, cooperative society. So they may be seller. They may be seller. Regarding buyer, there was some issue, but they may be seller. And again, kindly note that seller also includes an individual or HUF. But what is the provision? What is to be noted in this? We will include those individuals, those HUFs, whose total sales, gross receipts, or turnover from the business or profession carried on by them exceed the monetary limits specified under section 44AB during the financial year immediately preceding the financial year in which goods, which type of goods basically, specified goods are sold. So it must be noticed. Now, I think by this time you are already aware that it is basically applicable on specified goods. Specified goods, in case we deal with, in case specified goods are purchased or sold, in that, so first of all, we must know what is the definition of specified goods. Now, kindly note, what is covered under specified goods. So I have shown this in the diagram. Basically, six items, in case something is there that is to be used for some medical purpose, that will not be included. Then secondly, tendu leaves that are basically used for making a, you may say, like cigarettes are there, in the same way some bidis are there. So in order to make bidis. Then third is timber. Fourth is any forest produce, and at the fifth part it is scrap, and lastly some specified minerals, that is coal, lignite, and iron ore. So these are basically covered under specified goods. And what is the rate of TCS? What is the rate of TCS? Kindly note, on alcoholic liquor for human consumption it is 1%. Tendu leaves, it is 5%, and on timber, whether it is obtained under a forest lease or it has been obtained by any other mode other than the foreign lease or any other forest produce not being timber or tendu leaves, it is 2.5%. And as far as scrap is concerned, what is the meaning of scrap? It means waste which is not usable at all, which is simply waste. On it, it is, the rate applicable is 1%. On specified minerals, a rate applicable is 1%. And on motor car, we have already discussed that it is applicable on the motor car that is having a value of more than 10 lakh. In that case, again, it is 1%. In case the value of the motor vehicle is more than rupees 10 lakhs, it may be any motor vehicle. It is not so that it is applicable on the luxury cars only. So, and you must remember that in the last, as far as parking lot, toll plaza, mining and quarry is earlier, main rule is this only. But kindly note that any person who is paying any sum on which is covered under the, you may say, provisions of TCS and taxes collectible at source, it is his or her duty to furnish his or her PAN number to the collector. To the collector means to the person responsible for collecting such tax. Otherwise, what will happen? Kindly note, otherwise, collectee will have to pay tax at a higher rate. Now, what is the provision? The provision is, the rate applicable will be, in case PAN is not submitted, it will be twice of the specified TCS rate. For example, we have just discussed that in some points it is 2%, in some parts it is 1%, and in some parts it is 2.5%. So now the rate applicable will be double of that or 5%, whichever is higher. So it is always advisable that in case you know that TCS provisions are applicable, so it is your duty, it is always advisable to furnish your PAN number. Otherwise TCS will be collected at a higher rate. Again, in case you have not submitted PAN, we have discussed, but let us suppose PAN has been submitted, but that is not valid, that is invalid, or that doesn't belong to the collectee. In that case, it will be assumed, it will be deemed that the collectee has not furnished his PAN to the collector, and same provision will be applicable. But one exception is there, and dear students, kindly note that these provisions of a higher rate will not be applicable to a non-resident who doesn't have permanent establishment in India. So provisions regarding chargeability at a higher rate, these provisions I am talking of are not applicable to a non-resident who doesn't have any permanent establishment in India. Now, again, provisions regarding deductibility of surcharge, in case if any applicable, and health and education cess. Again, note, I have already told you in the beginning also that if the purchaser, buyer or licensee, lessee, as the case may be, is not a resident, rather he is a non-resident, non-corporate assessee or a non-domestic company, then surcharge, in case it is applicable, then health and education cess is also required to be collected. It is also required to be collected along with the aforesaid rate, along with the rates already mentioned, 1%, 2.5%, as applicable to a particular case. Now, again, you see one form is there, that is form number 27EQ. What is the nature of this form? It is used for furnishing the details of the tax collected at source by the seller. It denotes what amount has been collected by the seller, and it is required to be submitted on a quarterly basis by the seller. Now, a few points, small points, very basic point, I think from your exam point of view also, you must note it. Then what is the basic difference between TDS and TCS? First of all, TDS is basically tax deduction at source, and TCS is basically tax collection at source, its full form only. Now, who is responsible? In case of TDS, it is the duty of the payer, that is buyer, that is person who is availing the services. It is his or her duty to deduct a tax. Whereas it is not so in case of TCS. In case of it is the duty of the seller to, and it is the duty of the person who is granting some license, lease for parking, you may say license for parking, toll plaza, mine, quarry, and it is his or her duty to collect the tax. Now, what is the point of taxability? Again, note that it is basically based upon accounting only, as we do there in accounting. So, in case of TDS, what is the point of taxability? The time of credit to the account of the pay, or at the time of payment, whichever is earlier. Time of credit to the account of the pay, or at the time of payment, whichever is earlier. But only in case of salary, at the time of payment of salary and payment in respect of life insurance policy. In this case, it is applicable at the time of payment. Whereas, in case of TCS, I have already told you, just now in the previous slides, that in this case, the point of taxability will be the time of debiting the buyer or the time of receipt, whichever is earlier. But kindly note that in case of motor vehicle, in case of sale of motor vehicle of value exceeding rupees 10 lakh, it is only the time when the sale consideration is received. So it is the time of receipt of the sale consideration in that case. Again, note a few provisions are there and we are discussing it in brief. You see, what are the cases when TCS will not be applicable? So I have already told you in the, second slide, that government and institutions notified under UN, United Nations Privileges and Immunities Act 1947, and embassies, consulates, high commissions, legations, commission, trade representation of foreign states, they shall not be liable to TCS. Again, kindly note that this provision is main, and we have not discussed it earlier, that no collection of tax shall be made from resident buyer. In case the buyer furnishes to the person, you may say seller or the person collector or person who is responsible for collecting the tax, in case the buyer submits a declaration in writing and in duplicate, in prescribed form and verified in the prescribed manner, what is to be submitted, what is to be declared, that the goods are to be used, goods are to be utilized for the purpose of manufacturing, processing or producing articles or things, and for the purposes of generation of power, and these are not being purchased for trading purposes. In case it is declared and it is and submitted in a proper way, prescribed way, then TCS provisions will not be applicable and TCS will not be collected. Again, I think it is already clear to you that I think you know what is TAN number. So it is the duty of the person responsible for collecting tax at source, collecting TCS. It is applicable in TDS also. It is applicable in that case also, that it is the duty of the person collecting or deducting tax at source. The person should apply to the assessing officer for the allotment of a TAN number. Now, what is the full form of TAN number? Tax deduction and collection account number. It is common. It is common for TDS as well as TCS. Now, what are the time period? What is the time prescribed time to deposit TCS? I think you are clear that TCS is collected by the collector, by the seller, but ultimately it is to be deposited to the revenue, to the central government income tax department. Now, what is the procedure? In case office of government is there, and let us suppose case is ki tax is paid without production of income tax challan, in that case it should be deposited on the same day. But when government is there, office of government is there, and tax is paid and it is duly accompanied by an income tax challan. A proper income tax challan is there. In that case, it should be deposited on or before 7 days from the end of the month in which collection is made. Let us suppose it is made in November. So, from the end of the November, it should be submitted before 7th of December. Now, second category is there. In case collector is other than government, in that case, what is the time period? It is simply 1 week from the last day of the month in which such collection is made. So, dear students, that was all from my side as far as TCS is concerned. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.